see. Well, I can try to stand here, but just tell me if I'm going too far because I lose my mind. So yeah, I will talk about hand in hand human morphological traits and their mediation by a vascular mycorrhizal fungi. And this is super new for me to talk in front of a major non-scientific community. So I will try to talk in the way that everyone gets what I want to say and find the words. And I hope this will work out. So working with root traits, that's what I do. So I think this is, I have to define some terms here that we are actually on the same boat. And I think the term trait is the first one I have to define for you. And the definition I like the most is by Violet Al, which is a trait is any morphological, physiological, or phenological feature measurable at the individual level. And that basically just means that if we want to know something about a species, then we can actually look at whatever characteristic of the species. So it can be a morphological characteristic like the shape of the leaf or something like that. It can also be ecologically, like is it a plant that grows in one growing season or does it live over several decades? And it can also be like the tolerance to salt in the soil or whatever. So every possible characteristic of a plant or an animal or whatever can be measured somehow and then be a trait and be used as a species-specific characterism to characterize the species and to put it into a framework. And if we think about plants here, then that means that we can actually measure everything on leaves and on stems and on roots, because these are the three main organs of a plant, simply speaking. But in reality, the picture is different. So what you see here is a database search that I did in the beginning and in the end of my thesis in one of the largest openly available databases, which is the TRI database. So there are several online depositories for these trait data. Scientists measure them and then they just put them online. Hopefully, most of them keep them with themselves, but some do them open. And then everyone can use them, and we can actually merge them, and you can actually get an idea of the greater picture. And if you look into the database, so what we see here is the sizes of these pie charts are in respect to the number of observations of these traits in the database. And you see that there is a huge bias towards the above ground traits. So this is like about 3% of the entire traits are for roots, and the rest is for above ground parts, mainly leaves. And even there was an increase during the last years of about 100% in the entire database, we still had about 3% for roots in the end. So this bias is not going away. So the question is now, why is there such a strong bias? And there are several possible answers to this question. The first and most easy answer is just the effort that it takes to work with roots. So if you take a leaf, then you can just pick it and start immediately measuring. Well, when you work with roots, you have to dig them out the ground, you have to get your hands dirty, you have to wash them, you have to try to not destroy them while you wash them. You have to be sure that they really are the roots of that plant that you were looking on, and this is much more effort before you can even start measuring something. And second, there is the general assumption that roots are, as an organ, much more plastic than organs above, like a leaf. So people just think, or like also ecologists think, although there is no proof, that a leaf can basically be a bit smaller and a bit larger, but basically is a leaf. While the root is like growing around stones and going into niches and just like into close contact with the environment and very plastic in its behavior. And plasticity is always a problem when you want to know something about a species characteristic, because the more plastic something is, the less accurate is the mean value that you actually get in the end for the species. And third, and probably most important for me as an ecologist, is the problem that there's the so-called plant economic spectrum hypothesis, and this hypothesis assumes actually a unison of the above and the below ground parts of the plant, and under the assumptions of this hypothesis, it is claimed that roots are more or less redundant in their patterns to the above ground traits along specific gradients. And if it would be so, then actually digging them out is not worth it. So what is behind this plant economic spectrum hypothesis? So the main idea of this is actually a gradient from resource acquisition to resource conservation, being two ends of a gradient that a plant can actually be on. And the idea is that an entire plant, including all organs, so also leaves and roots, would sit on or locate on one specific point of this gradient. So a plant that would be resource acquisitive would have a high specific leaf area, so a high area in respect to the investment of dry biomass, and also a high specific root length, so very long roots for not so much investment of biomass. And this would both mean that the plant is investing into surface maximization for catching up sunlight above ground and assimilating the nutrients from the soil. While on the other side of the gradient, on the resource conservative end, a plant would have a low specific leaf area and a low specific root length, that would actually mean that a plant is investing a lot of dry matter content of tissue into the stabilization of the organ and actually into the longevity of the organ. So during the last years, there were some hints in the literature and some emerging evidence that roots might decouple from the patterns that we find above ground, and it could be actually really worth it to get your hands dirty and try to get the data on them, especially because they are in pretty close contact to their soil environment. And soil is a very diverse environment, and there's a lot going on, and this close interaction with the roots is something that we think is, or like that is a striking point that this might not be mirrored in the patterns above ground in the leaves. So what is going on below ground? One thing I have to define here, I wanted to talk because it's part of the title of this talk, is the arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi. So those are a monophyletic group. That means that they're brothers and sisters, and all closely relatives, and they are obligate plant symbionts. So that means they cannot live without a plant partner. So if the spore of an arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi germinates in the soil, and the hyphae is growing out the spore, and it doesn't find a plant partner in a certain time frame, then it's actually dying because it cannot synthesize carbon by itself, so it's not doing photosynthesis or taking it up from other organic sources, but it can just take it up from a living plant, and it's doing this by growing into the root and forming arbuscules, which are a structure to get more surface where the fungal partner is actually touching into the into the cell of the plant to get as much contact as possible to interchange the carbon from the plant for nutrients from the soil, mainly phosphorus, but also other nutrients. And those nutrients are not easy for the plant to be taken up, but the fungi can easily take it up, and it locates them to the plant and gets carbon back, which is the plant synthesizing by photosynthesis. And outside of the roots, the fungal partner is creating those extra radical hyphae, and they can be super long if you would align them like kilometers of hyphae from around one single root, and it's actually a huge surface maximization for the plant. And it is hypothesized that this is one of the major major topics that was necessary for plants to colonize the land when they came out of the water. And we know that today it's about 80% of the land plant families that are in this close contact and form these mycorrhizal structures. So how does this look like to make it a bit more visual? So what we see here is such an arbuscule, and this is really like a super fine structure, and the term arbuscule, I think it's obvious where it comes from. It looked like a tree. And it's like has super, super fine branches. And the hyphae itself, they are growing between the cells, all along the cell, and then they are entering the cell at a certain point, not really the protoplasm of the cell, but it's touching the protoplasm at a huge surface. And there are also other forms of mycorrhizal fungi. This is an ectomycorrhizal fungi, which builds a mantle around the root, and there are different forms, but I am mainly working with the vascular mycorrhizal fungi. And here you again see that these fungi might be growing into a cell, so there is a lot of surface and of close touch between the fungi and the plant. And even more, there is not just this exchange of carbon and phosphorus, but also we know that plants can actually communicate via the hyphal network. So we know that the hyphal network of the vascular mycorrhizal fungi do interlink different plants of the same and also different species in the soil, and that actually signaling compounds of a plant, if it is stressed or whatever, can actually go within or along. We don't know now, like how perfectly it's going, but it can actually go through the mycorrhizal network and go to another plant and actually communicate with each other. So there is a lot going on below ground, which is done by the vascular mycorrhizal symbiosis. So to come to my work now, the latest paper of my thesis, which I will talk about, and my basic idea here was to actually check if this assumption that roots are just analogs of background traits within this plant economic spectrum, if this theory really holds, if we have a huge data set on a lot of species. And to check this, I measured root traits on 141 different grassland species from Germany, and I grew them in pots in the greenhouse on a sterilized soil sand mix, and I added a microbial wash, so I washed out all the microbial spores and inocula from the soil from a very diverse community, put it all in so that the plant has the choice to actually interact with whatever it wants to. And I harvested after 8 weeks, so pretty short time. It's not so easy to do a greenhouse experiment because the roots grow like crazy and you have to wash them afterwards and still get information out of it. So you have to either check if you just take a bit or you take a young root, so different ways to do it. And then I washed them and I put it on glass slides filled with water on the scanner and just took photographs out of it, which you see here. And those can be analyzed by a computer analyzed system, the WinRISO system, and it actually gives morphological traits like the average diameter of the root and then the overall length of the root, and if we divide the length by the dry biomass of the root, we get the specific root length, and we can also measure the specific root surface area, the specific root volume, and the so-called tissue density, so the investment of tissue into the volume, and the percentage of fine roots. And because I wanted to check the variation and the pattern in these below ground traits over this 141 species would be explainable by above ground traits, I also needed above ground traits. And I decided not to measure them on the plants because I couldn't measure so many. So I decided to take all of them from a database, because I would have taken some from the plants and some from a database that would have always been the bias towards the ones measured on the plants. So I took all my traits from databases, and I took morphological traits like the leaf traits that we would expect to be the main predictors of our below ground variability, but also ecological and life history related traits of all of my species. And I ended up with 97 different traits that I took from the database. And what I wanted to do was to take those traits and try to predict the pattern that emerged in my below ground root traits. And you can do so by implementing a machine learning approach. So this is just a computer machine learning approach that uses the random forest. Now this is a super science talk, so I will probably go over this one. But what you actually do is that the system is taking all the predictors and all possible interactions between the predictors and builds up a model to predict the variability or the patterns in the below ground traits. And I also included information about the phylogenetic relatedness of the species, because it is known that phylogeny is the main predictor between differences, of course, because differences emerge from evolution. So species that are closely related should be more similar just in theory. So this was also included as pairwise distances between the species. And what you get out when you do such an analysis is that for every response trait, you get a set of significant predictors, so a set of above ground traits that actually are meaningful to explain the patterns below ground. And those can be ranked due to their percentage of predicted variance, so it's very analytical. And what was the first thing that was obvious for me when I looked at the content of the sets was that my traits clustered in two groups. So I have a group that was actually different information about root fineness, so the average diameter and the specific root length and the percentage of fine roots and the specific root surface area. And then I had two traits that were actually related to the investment of tissue in the root. So the root tissue density itself and the specific root volume. And those were pretty, like within each group, they were pretty close in their predicting sets. And let's look on that one side. So what I found for the tissue density related traits was that the so-called leaf dry matter content was the main predictor. And this is exactly what we would predict under the assumptions of this plant economic spectrum hypothesis, that the investment of tissue, so the investment of dry biomass into the maximization of the surface of the leaf, is the main predictor of the same thing below ground, meaning the tissue investment into the volume of the root. So this is exactly what we would expect. But on the other hand, when we look at the other side, then I found that the so-called specific leaf area, which would be the trait that we would have expected to be the main predictor, because the specific leaf area is actually how much area you produce to catch up the sunlight. And this should be related to the fineness of the root, because fineness of root is also an informative proxy for taking up nutrients from the soil. And this one was only significant in one of those sets and pretty far downstream, so just like 3% of the variation was explained by that one. But instead, the main predictor of all of those were the diaspore mass. The diaspore is just a term for the seed including something that is around the seed if there is something. So just think about the seed. This is just a more this diaspore mass was the main predictor of variability and by far the main predictor. So for me this was absolutely surprising, and in the beginning I had no idea how this could be, so I had to actually come up with an ecological meaning for this result. And so I looked into the actual data, and the effect that was really visible in the data was that those plants with the heavier seeds were the ones with the coarser roots. And what we know from the literature is that heavier seeds don't travel so far from the mother plant, with the exception of animal dispersal. So if an ant or someone is taking the seed and taking it away, of course it can travel as far as possible. But just if it's just dispersed by wind or by sheer ballistic falling down dispersal, then the weight of the seeds is correlated to the distance from the mother plant. So that means the heavier seeds germinate closer to the mother plant. And a seedling that grows closer to the mother plant by default comes into contact with the soil biota that were already trained from the mother in the surrounding soil. So the mother is already colonized by the perfectly fitting arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi that help her growing, but also by the pathogens that attack her. And both are enriched in the surrounding area of the soils of the mother plant. And what we also know and what fitted the picture is that exactly plants that are mycorrhizal do have heavier seeds. That is known from the literature, and it was also true for my data set. I could confirm it there. So a plant that is mycorrhizal has actually the potential to not invest into fine roots, but into coarse roots, and this is what really happens. AM fungal plants have coarser roots. And if you have the fungal partner that take over the role of the fine roots in nutrient assimilation, then you can invest in a coarse root, which is actually the habitat for the fungi to grow in. And by doing so, you also get another advantage, which is that you are not as strongly attackable by pathogens, because we know that the finer the roots, the better attackable for a pathogen fungi. So this actually closed the circle. So a plant that has coarser roots that enables an vascular micro as a partner to take over the fine root proxies and is better protected from a pathogen, and this is achievable by having the heavier seeds and don't travel so far from the mother plant. So what was actually possible by doing this analysis, in the beginning I just wanted to check if this variation below ground is explainable by above ground, but on top of this I found one possible explanation of this variability below ground not to be explained from above ground, and exactly by this plant-soil interaction which actually shape the differences in root fibers between all of these species. And with this, I want to thank you.
Wow, thank you so much. Great talk. I'm myself very interested in mutualism right now, so I have many questions I want to ask you later. But maybe one question first, before I open up to the audience. Is it known how this mutualism between the plant and the fungi developed? Is there some kind of knowledge about that?
Well, we know that it goes back pretty far. So the first land plants that we have as fossils are already colonized by vascular mycorrhizal fungi. This is what we know. How exactly it happened, like the first fungi that ever entered the cell, I cannot tell you. But of course it changed during the time. So the first vascular mycorrhizal fungi weren't so effective. You can see on the pictures that the ovoscules are not as fine as today, so there was obviously evolution going on, and it must be a close evolution because mutualism is always both partners try to be perfect for the other to stay close together. But how it actually started, we don't know.
Yeah, I'm always wondering how much is that actually due to chance happening, that, you know, that's...
chance is always a part of it.
Are there questions from the audience? Yes, I asked a question.
Hi there. Congratulations on Petaidilung.
Thank you.
The relationship between the root traits and the AMF that you just described, what are the chances of extrapolating that to species that are not grasslands or forbs, or maybe even trees? And if yes or if not, what will be the impact for crop production in those grounds? Thanks.
So this picture that I showed here, I think is specifically true for grasslands, because I only have grassland species here, so I cannot say that it can be extrapolated, and I really don't think it can be extrapolated, because when you think about this part here, the dispersal distance, then this is just true if you stay approximately in one height of plant. So if you go to, for example, a tree, then the height of the tree is a very important mediator of the distance that the seed travels, because the so-called terminal velocity and the wind that can drive it away is actually a very important predictor, a very important mediator of the distance. And I think there is assumption, I mean, it can be tested, but I wouldn't be surprised if it doesn't hold for larger plants. But for crop plants, I mean, this is always also different, because for crop plants, yeah, you have high breeding impact, and crop plants are already breeded for plasticity of the roots to counterpart the soil if it's not perfect. So there's also other factors that might actually have an overlaying effect on this one. And it also it's always a problem. I mean, we know that in agriculture they even put specific plants in between as intercrops to foster the assimilation of the vascular mycorrhizal in the soil to have more vascular mycorrhizal fungi afterwards. But still, it's not so easy to control this for agriculture management.
There's a question in the first row.
Hi. Yeah, I was wondering about this mutualism, because on one hand it seems to, in many cases, to be mutually beneficial and very balanced, but then there are, I think, some other cases, like the honey mushroom that was brought up earlier, that sometimes functions mutually, but sometimes takes a weak tree and basically infects and eats it out. Is there this, in your studies or in other studies, the variety of this, you know, situation,
yeah,
kind of balance, imbalance?
Yeah, there is a continuum. It's called the parasitism-mutualism continuum, and it actually says that a fungal partner can be both mutualistic and also parasitic. So AMF are always assumed to be the good guys, and I think overall they are. but if the nutrition condition for the plant is perfect, so the plant is actually bombarded with phosphorus and actually doesn't need the fungal partner to get it up, but it is already colonized by the fungal partner, then it is not so easy for the plant to shut down the allocation of sugar to the fungi. So then it could actually be then a parasitic effect, because the fungi is still taking up his side of the duties by not giving away anything. But there is also regulation of both sides. So both the fungal and the plant partner are able to regulate the symbiosis, but just to a certain point.
So maybe Spila wants to come up to the stage and we have a conversation, the three of us. Yeah, thank you again. I like very much what Regina did with us, and like introducing the possibility that we can also like just address questions amongst us. But my first question that I would like to address to you both is about your methods. And we earlier already spoke about Tim Ingold, and he said that this involvement, and especially physical involvement, is very important in order to gain a certain understanding. And I was wondering about your methods of involvement, because you both somehow seem to have a very subjective and very active role in the work that you are doing. And I was wondering how important you think that is in order for you to do what you are doing.
Well, yeah, I mean, if we talk about the methods in science, then we always have to see like what is doable and what makes sense and what is accurate, but how much time investment is needed to make it as accurate as possible. And it's always a balance thing. And this is especially true for the root washing and scanning, because you're never perfect in what you do. You try to make everything as clean as possible. But at a certain point, you start to lose fine roots by washing the roots, and then you start to lose something of the picture. There is a so-called handbook of protocols for standardized trait measurement. There's a super cute sentence that I like very much for washing roots, is that they say, when you wash roots, then stop at the moment where the amount of dirt that you wash out is equal to the amount of roots that you lose, or better, slightly before. And this is actually, this is what we always do. We try to find the perfect balance between investment and necessity, and to get the most accurate values. But I think it is super important. What I also see when I work with students is you cannot just say, do it and explain it theoretically. You always have to have the material at hand. So when I explain it once, then I always come back like an hour later and I see how they really perceive what I said, because just theoretically is not enough. You really have to have a feeling on what it is. And people sometimes come to me and say, well, I have roots there and I wanna wash and scan them. And can you like shortly explain me how to do it and then tell me how long it might take, because I want to plan my experiment. I always say I cannot tell you before I haven't had them in hand, because it really depends on the substrate and on the growing duration and how well they were the nutrients in the soil and how much there is and how fine they are. You really have to have them in hand to touch them and to see what it is like, because just theoretically it can be absolutely different. You go out in the field, I also took a lot of samples from the field, not for that experiment, but for others. And then you sometimes think, well, I just go there and I take it out and I put it into the bag, and then you come there and it is a super loamy soil and it was dry for the last 3 weeks, and you actually have to get out a brick from the ground, and then you can immediately stop the sampling campaign because you don't get any information. So it is a lot about the physical contact with what you do, otherwise it's not going.
I'm going to ignore your question and ask you. You're describing the process in terms of science again, you know, as if all scientists were equal, but you seem to have sort of a feeling. So I was wondering, how did you come up with this hypothesis? Like, what was it intuition? Was it actual papers that you read with, like, this? The investment hypothesis.
Well, yeah. So this plant economic hypothesis is not mine. This is published, but to check if it holds. Yeah. It was in the beginning intuition because I was trained as a morphologist and as a plant morphologist and not as an ecologist, and. I like this thinking in concepts. I like to do it, but I always think that it is oversimplifying the reality. So it's like when you think in these concepts, it's always too simple because nature is much more complex. And when I read about the concept, I thought, well, it's a nice idea to get greater pictures, but actually I don't buy it because I think that evolution. And I was trained as an evolutionary morphologist, so I was really always interested in which evolutionary pressure was behind a certain morphology. And I think that it didn't catch me the fact that roots is just the same than leaves, and it's just about the uptake of whatever the plant needs. It was much too simple for me, and that's why I started to look into the literature, and then I found certain papers that actually said, well, under certain conditions, there might be a decoupling, and I thought, well, it's probably not just under certain conditions, I just think that there is a decoupling, and of course, overall, there might be a general trend, but you always have to keep in mind that it's not as simple as it looks like.
I like that you ignored my questions. Totally fine, really. I like questions from the audience. There is one question over there.
So I have a question to both speakers. First, the shorter one. I would just ask Joanna about this image that we have here. Is it a drawing or is it a photograph or is it a scan or what kind of technology? It has some. What do you think is the. Does this image have some scientific value for you in your research? Because it for sure has some aesthetical value, and I'm interested in this. How it is entangled together, the artistic and scientific value of this. And the other question to Spela, if I'm pronouncing right your name, is about a relation between you and that plant, or that more than a plant creature, in the context of understanding subjectivity, because you your talk was very personal. You are talking about this relation as if you were two individuals. So I'd like to address here the problem of individuality. You are individual, but when you talk about her, because you talk like her, like it was in two different ways. Once, as it were some kind of relation, sexual relation between two women, and the other moment as you were her mother. So there were these two kinds of things. What is interesting to me is so you are individual for sure, but when you talk about her, do you talk about also another individual or about a species? Is it an individual creature or just another species? Because you rather think about yourself more than as an individual or more than a representative of Homo sapiens in this relation. But was it actually still you, or are your parts, fluids, tissues, or cells still you? So I think it's also a question of the bodily dimensions of the subjectivity in this relation. Could you refer in any way to that?
Yeah, I know, but... No, thank you. Actually, you kind of... what you said could as well have been a statement rather than a question, because I can sort of explain, because I have thought about these things, but not necessarily didn't come to an answer, nor do I want to, because they're sort of important questions. So with this confronting vegetal otherness opus, I have actually a series of works. I recognize actually that it's kind of different. The question of the individual comes up a lot when you're sort of comparing humans to plants. It's one of the differences that our sort of conception of this border, this animal or human animal that ends, can be conceived of. Of in terms of having an autonomy and an internality, a sort of a hierarchy, a subjectivity. And this seems to be absent in plants. And you can have perhaps, before we knew all about these mycorrhizae, and trees seem to be like an example of a plant that would be very individual, right? And this is completely now being deconstructed through science. Whereas grass, or like algae, it comes down to that they have a different principle of organization, but maybe humans as well are viewed in a very particular frame in this time, in this kind of culture, where perhaps the connection to the ancestors or like this kind of lineage is not so pronounced as much as this individual, self-made human. So I recognize that there are differences, and actually, depending on where you position yourself, the relationship to humans will also be different. I wanted to perform a series of artistic experiments that would address these different levels. So one looked at this communication or the intercognition between humans and plants on the level of cells. So it was about a micro-performance between algae cells and human cancer cells that made this interaction. And, if you look at human as cancer cells, you're kind of faced with the same conundrum as if you were looking at algae as plant cells, right? They're material, and they lack this individuality. And there was actually some protests around the fact that, it's not really a human if it's cancer. I could argue this. And then on the other side of the spectrum, you have plant communities versus human communities, and like this kind of deep time, and there would also there could be some communication or evolutionary adaptation where actually it seems to be more acceptable, less causing friction to conceive of. The apple somehow using humans to spread itself throughout the world as much as the humans are growing apples. And then that gets complicated because of the seeds and they're not reproducing them. But there were actually two artworks where I kind of was playing the human at the same time, me as an individual, but also this assumption of what we have about humans. And this human was looking at the plant, asking for a conversation one-on-one. And that, you know, that's already a fallacy from the start, so it didn't happen. But I kind of engaged in this, and also this also happened through this Scotto Poesis, where I was casting a shadow on germinating cress for 20 hours. So I was literally obstructing this path of light, and the cress then sort of changed its shape, its morphology because of this. And again, it was a process of signaling. But then you had a sort of a similar unresolved situation of this human individual looking for a conversation partner, but when again, you know. So maybe just to say that I'm not in the know, you know, like I'm also asking myself this question about the value of this anthropomorphization. I think that we shouldn't dismiss it immediately, like in terms of yeah, knowing that the plant is not like you, but nevertheless allowing yourself, suspending this disbelief, this radical difference, and just using your empathy to observe, to see, you know, to construct sort of something that might not be fully truthful to this otherness, but it's very benevolent, and it might be the best tool that you have. And one other thing, the mother and the daughter, and like the father of this kind of confusion, yes, all that. but the tail crest, and this is also a matter of naming, right? Because I was talking about the tail crest, the phytopolitoons were actually the babies that have been kind of changed, and they're genetically plants and morphologically mostly plants, with a little bit of sprinkle of this human essence. So it was this material connection. I wouldn't claim that, you know, the hormones are me. I wouldn't claim that the nail that I clip off my finger is me. It's a part, right, and this kind of interaction that happens. And the tail crest was this other mother.
Well, you're right, it's a drawing, and I used it to just make a slide in between out of the PowerPoint presentation, but it is more, you're right, because for me, I always said also, like, it was always a visual thing for me to work with plants, because they are, I mean, as a biologist, you start working with animals and plants and genes and biochemistry and everything. And for me, it was immediately clear when I started to work that plants just catch me emotionally by their symmetry. They are so mathematical for me, because everything is like, if you cut them, everything has a symmetry, and it's really opening my heart if I look at this. And roots, like if you cut the root, of course it is also symmetric, but as a system it is pretty flexible, but still super beautiful. So I love it a lot. And if you put them on the scanner, they always look pretty dead, because they are dead. You wash them and then you put them there, and they don't look like in nature. But there is one book, the so-called Wurzel Atlas, the root atlas, and there are hundreds of hand drawings from living roots. So there were two people that actually dedicated their entire life to go out in the field and dig deep holes, which they could stand in with at the ground level of the plant, and they dig the hole as deep that they reach the lowest level of the root of the plant in one slide, and then they started drawing all the roots that they can see in one dimension. And it's an incredible work that they both have done, and it's a thick book, and it smells delicious, and I love it a lot. And this is one of the pictures out of the book, and I cannot even tell you which plant it is, because I just looked through the pictures, but this one was one that just...
What are the outdoors?
Yeah. I was thinking about it a minute ago, and actually...
Can I find it?
Yes. It's the Wurzel Atlas, yeah. Wurzel Atlas. If the names come back in the next minutes, I tell you. And yeah, this is why I took it, because I like it, and for me it's more than just the dead roots on the scanner, but it's actually a living root, and I just think that it's super nice to look at.
I think can we take one more question shortly, should Sally move that question to the reception later, and I want to thank again our speakers of the last panel of today. Thank you very much.